Welcome back to our lecture series, Math 1060, Trigonometry for Students at Southern Utah University. As usual, I'll be your professor today, Dr. Andrew Misseldine. Let's talk some more about complex numbers. You'll remember from a previous video, we've introduced Euler's identity, which tells us how to deal with imaginary exponents. If you see something of the form e to the I theta, this is actually the same thing as cosine theta plus I times sine of theta, where theta is some angle in radians right there. This gives us the most general complex form when we throw on some modulus r, right, where r could be any positive real number or zero, I suppose. And this gives us the polar form or the trigonometric form of a complex number. So what's the point of the polar form? Well, when it comes to adding and subtracting complex numbers, there's really not a huge advantage. Actually, the polar form makes it a little bit more difficult to add and subtract these things. But when it comes to multiplication and division, the polar form is actually the superior method for doing this complex algebra. And I'd like to illustrate that to you here in lecture 33. So let's first talk about multiplication. Suppose we have two complex numbers, we'll call it z1 and z2. Remember, we like to use the complex variable z instead of x or y when we talk about these complex numbers here. So imagine that z1 is given so that its modulus is r1. Again, we like to use r here because we're thinking of it as the radius of a circle in the complex plane. So z1 equals r1 times cosine theta 1 plus I sine theta 1, right? So this thing right here is just equal to r1 times e to the I theta 1, just the theta 1 right there, just the polar form of that complex number. Likewise, z2 is given as r2 times cosine theta 2 plus I sine theta 2. Again, using Euler's identity, this is equal to r2 times e to the I theta 2, like so. So when it comes to multiplying these together, if you multiply together z1 with z2, you're going to multiply together the moduli. Okay, that makes sense. R1 times R2. But then you're going to add together the arguments. You're going to take cosine of theta 1 plus theta 2, and then plus I sine of theta 1 plus theta 2. So you just add together the arguments, you add together the angles, and you multiply together the moduli. Why is that the case? Well, if you try to do it without Euler's identity, this becomes a very, very intense trigonometric identity type argument there. There's a lot that goes on there, but you don't need Euler's identity. It can be done with just trigonometric identities alone. You have to use some angle sum identities. It's quite involved there. Look in your trig book, and you probably can find the proof there. We will, of course, use the superior argument of Euler's identity, which I confess in our lecture series, we didn't prove it because we don't have calculus. But for most of you, you'll eventually take calculus, and therefore you'll be quite qualified to see that proof. So if you just do a little bit of suspension of belief, then I think we're going to be just fine here. So z1 is equal to r1 e to the I theta 1, and z2 is equal to r2 e to the I theta 2. Theta 2, like so. And so if we recognize that these are in fact imaginary exponents, then just by usual rules of multiplication, we can commute. We're going to put the R1 and R2 together, moduli. We're going to put the exponentials together as well, e to the I theta 1, e to the I theta 2. And so in terms of multiplying the moduli, we're already done, right? Isn't that what we were looking for? An R1, R2. We already have that. So that makes sense. When you multiply two complex numbers, you multiply together their moduli. But why are we adding the arguments? Well, in terms of these exponential expressions, when you multiply together an exponential, you add the exponents. Oh yeah, I remember learning that. You get e to the I theta 1 plus I theta 2. But as there's that common factor of I, you can factor it out. So you get R1, R2, and you're going to get e to the I times theta 1 plus theta 2, like so. And then if we were to translate this from its trigonometric form back to the expanded form, the Cartesian form there, you'll end up with R1, R2 times cosine of, in this case, the angle is going to be theta 1 plus theta 2. And then you add to that I sine of theta 1 plus theta 2, like so. So we can go back and put it into this cosine I sine form, like we see right here. And so we see that, okay, we add the angles as a consequence of just usual exponent rules. If you have imaginary exponent, we do that. And I like to think of this argument instead, not as some again, crazy trigonometric identity proof that no one will remember. This is something that you can remember. It's like, oh, you multiply together exponentials by adding the exponents. That's why we add the angles, because theta, the angle, the argument, is the exponent of this complex exponential expression. So let's show you how you can do these calculations. Well, if your numbers are already given in polar form, then it's very easy to multiply them together. We're going to multiply together their moduli, so you get 3 times 5, and then you're going to add together their arguments. All right, so you're going to have e to the I times 2 pi over 9 plus pi over 18. That's how we go from there. So we multiply together the moduli, that's easy enough. You'll get 3 times 5, which is 15. And then we have to add together the exponents. Well, since we need a common denominator, 18 is what our target should be. So let's replace this with 4 pi over 18. And then when we add those together, we end up with e to the I over 5 pi over 18, like so. And then that's the product of these two complex numbers. When they're in polar form, the product is pretty easy. The worst it ever gets is we might have to write together fractions, you know, add together fractions, and we found a common denominator. I think I might be able to live with that. Now, of course, if the complex number is not in its polar form, we have to make a choice. We can multiply them together the old-fashioned way, or we can convert them to the polar form and multiply them together. So let's try the Cartesian approach here. If we take z1 times z2, in this case, z1 is 1 plus I root 3, and z2 is negative root 3 plus I, like so. We then get 1 plus, well, I root 3 times negative root 3 plus I, like so. We got to FOIL this thing out. So we're going to get 1 times negative root 3. We'll get 1 times I. We'll get I root 3 times negative root 3, so that's a negative 3i. And then we're going to get an I root 3 times I, that's going to be a negative square root of 3. Notice I times I is negative 1. Combining like terms, we end up with a negative 2 root 3, and then we get a negative 2i. So this is the product, and that honestly wasn't so bad. I mean, basic FOIL method, not the worst thing in the world. What would happen if we wanted to, of course, compute the product using the polar form? Well, if that's the case, we have to convert these things first over to the polar form. So let's think about that for a second. If we compute the modulus of z1, that's going to equal the square root of 1 squared plus the square root of 3 squared. 1 squared, of course, is 1. The square root of 3 squared is clearly 3. So you get the square root of 4 here. That gives you a 2. All right. What is the argument, the arg of z1 there? You're a pirate for a moment. What's the argument there? You're supposed to take tangent inverse of root 3 over 1, right? When is tangent equal to the square root of 3? That happens at pi thirds. Sine is root 3 over 2, cosine is 1/2 in that situation. So that takes care of z1. We got to convert over z2 next. So for z2, it's modulus, like so. Same basic calculation. You're going to end up with, in this case, the square root of negative root 3 squared plus 1 squared. That's, again, going to be a 2. Same basic calculation as before. Let's be a pirate again for a moment. Let's calculate arg of z2. So this would be arctangent of negative 1 over root 3. Now remember, tangent, sine over cosine. So how do you get the fraction 1 over root 3? That happens when sine is 1/2 and cosine is root 3 over 2. That's going to happen at a pi 6 reference angle, but let's focus on the quadrant right here, right? The original value, we had x negative root 3 over 2, negative square root of 3, that's a negative value. And then the y coordinate is 1, so that's positive. So if you have negative x and positive y, that would suggest you're going to be in the second quadrant. Of course, our first one was plus and plus, so that put us in the first quadrant, of course. But we're in the second quadrant, so we need the angle which references to pi sixth in the second quadrant. That's going to be 5 pi over sixth, like so. And so now we can convert these things over to their polar form. So we get z1 times z2. This is equal to 2e to the I pi thirds times 2e to the I 5 pi thirds, pi sixth, excuse me. And so then when we put these together, you're going to get 2 times 2, which is 4. Then we have to add together the arguments there. Since I need a common denominator of 6, I'm going to write the first one, rewrite it, of course, as 2 pi sixth, like so. So when I add those together, you're going to end up with 7 pi sixth as the angle, like so. And so this gives us the trigonometric form, or if you wanted, you could write in the more expanded form, 4 times cosine of 7 pi sixth plus I sine of 7 pi sixth, of course, like that. Oh, I need another parenthesis. It went off the screen. There you go. And so that gives us the product as well. And so which one is better, right? Well, that's the same number, so it really doesn't matter, I suppose. It just depends on which form do you need. Like, again, with multiplication, it really is easier to do it in the polar form. Although, in this situation, since we start off in the Cartesian form, there is a cost of transitioning. But are these even the same numbers, right? Let's think about that for a second. Cosine of 7 pi over 6. 7 pi over 6, this is, of course, an angle in the third quadrant. It's will reference to pi sixth. So this would be the same thing as negative 4 cosine of pi sixth. And same thing over here in the third quadrant, sine is negative. So you get negative 4i. You distribute that 4 there. Negative 4i sine of pi sixth, like so. So cosine of pi sixth is root 3 over 2. And then we get sine of pi sixth, which is going to be 1/2. And that then simplifies to give us the negative 2 root 3 plus, minus 2i, like we saw before. So the two products, in fact, do agree with each other. And it might look like the polar approach is more difficult. And that's only because we go through all these conversions to show that we converted from the polar to the Cartesian so we could see it's the same result. Also, we had to convert from Cartesian to polar so that we could actually do it in the polar method. So don't get deceived by the translation process. It really is much simpler to multiply in the polar form. But of course, since there is a cost to translation, when it comes to doing complex products, we have to make a decision. Where is it more efficient just to do it the old-fashioned way, the Cartesian way, or maybe is the translation worth it? It might not seem like it on this example, but we'll get to examples very soon where it'll be highly advantageous to do exactly that translation.